And welcome to the Bharat Vartha podcast. I'm Roshan Karyappa. It's a pleasure for us to host Gautam Chintamani ji. Gautam ji is a film historian and author. His books include Dark Star, The Loneliness of Being Rajesh Khanna, Kayamat Se Kayamat Tak, the film that revived Hindi cinema, and Rajneeti, a biography on Shri Rajnath Singh ji. His writing has featured in numerous national publications. Gautam ji has a book out now called The Midway Battle, based on where we are right now in the Modi government's second term. And given just how many things have happened in the past couple of years, this should be an interesting conversation. So let's get started. Gautam ji, welcome to Bharat Vartha. Thank you so much for making the time.
Thank you. It's entirely my pleasure and great to be here.
Fantastic. So I'd love to start with the Midway Battle. The title is catchy. And while researching, I found a bunch of World War II references also to that phrase, right? Why do you think this is the Midway Battle for Prime Minister Modi? And if you could also back up a little bit and talk about, you know, what inspired you about the subject specifically.
So Roshan, you're right about the World War Battle and the reference to that. My father-in-law, who's an ex-army officer, he's the one who suggested that. I had been intrigued by the first term of Prime Minister Modi and the kind of ground that the government had covered in terms of social programs and in terms of internal security, but most importantly, making a shift when it came to how India perceived itself and how the world perceived India. So for me, the midway battle is not just about the roller coaster second term of Prime Minister Modi and we are right at the midpoint of it. But it is also about where India stands at 75 years of independence, where India stands today in the world, where the world stands. There has been a concerted shift when it comes to how countries operate, how the world looks at the world around itself, especially in the post-coronavirus pandemic world. A lot of things have completely changed. So for me, I was very intrigued to see what the second term would bring when it comes to the Modi government, because a lot of work had been done in the first term and how you would build more on the foundation that was laid. Also, it becomes a very important time in India's history because the kind of shift that India was experiencing, especially when it came to pitching itself as a world leader, especially foreign policy, the change in India's foreign policy, the slight shift where India is actually staking its true claim at the world table. And the world was taking notice of that, especially post-coronavirus. India has emerged as an alternative to China, not just because we are also a 1 billion plus country, we are a big market, so on and so forth, but also because India is strongly rooted in its democratic values. It's the constitution of this country which runs this country. And these are things which are very important in today's world, because you can see that there is an influx of the Chinese Communist Party's ideology and mentality, especially when it comes to universities in most countries, countries like, and I refer to this in my book, countries like Australia, United Kingdom, the United States. Yeah. The think tanks and the higher education setup in these countries has been infiltrated, if that is the word I can use for the want of a better term, by the CCP's deep pockets and trying to put the communist party's ideology out there. So you had the BRI, which is a physical project. You had the Digital Silk Route, which was trying to dominate the internet sphere. And this is a world where we may not have conventional battles anymore. It's a world where cybersecurity becomes very important. It's a world where, especially for India, you have enemies staring at you at two sides. You have Pakistan, you have ISI-backed propaganda, an agenda, you have the CCP-backed propaganda, and to think that these countries will not do anything, especially at a time where India is going through a huge transformation, would be naive. So all these factors came into being, and I started looking at Prime Minister Modi's second term from this aspect, and I wanted to take a stock. And also very interestingly, in the run-up to the 2019 elections, BJP's manifesto, the Sankalp Patra that they came out with, very interestingly also pointed out 75 milestones which were to coincide with the 75th anniversary of our independence. And I think perhaps for the first time in living memory, at least, the manifesto also gave milestones which the government was answerable on at the midpoint of their term. So all these things came into being, and I really wanted to look at a time where the work that you had been doing would start to show results. And that happens at the midway point, and especially where we are, it's almost like a battle, because if you look at the introduction of farm laws, where for the first time that agriculture sector was moving from, say, a state-controlled stronghold to a more free market-based setup, and the opposition, which you know it is facing. All these things are a huge transformation undertaking place in India's history right now, and that is what the book looks at, especially where we stand and also the historical context.
Yeah, these are fantastic circumstances, right? I mean, if you would have said this to anyone 5 or 10 years back, I mean, it would look like almost a work of fiction where we are right now. You know, I want to delve into multiple aspects of the book and, you know, what you brought up in your opening comments. But let me start with this, right? So you've spoken about how the first term set up some of the things like, you know, the welfare schemes that we're seeing right now in the second term, right? I mean, could you talk about that? I mean, in some sense, what was that long-term thinking and vision in the first term that, you know, is bearing fruit at this point?
I think one of the biggest contributions of Modi government's first term would be the successful bridging of the last mile when it comes to social programs, when it comes to government programs, or anything that the government is doing for the people. There's this very famous oft-repeated quote of the late Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi, that only 15 paisa or some little minuscule amount is what ultimately reaches the beneficiary when it comes to government programs. And that thing has been repeated by a lot of prime ministers. In fact, I remember that when I.K. Gujral was the prime minister, and during his Independence Day speech from the Red Fort, he made a note of corruption and how corruption was eating into the progress of this country and how that needed to be taken care of. Prime Minister Rao, I think in his 92 or 93 speech, also mentioned that, you know, institutionalized corruption needs to be taken care of. So all these things indicate towards bridging or the lack of the final gap. Now, whatever was done, be it opening up of bank accounts, be it the Jan Dhan Yojana or the health schemes or welfare schemes, the Modi government made people an active participant in fulfilling and bridging of this gap. So when the Prime Minister asked for people to give up subsidiaries willingly, you saw the huge number of people who gave up freebies, if I can use that term, in order to contribute to nation building. So these things which, say, take for instance, 1969, the nationalizing of banks was done on the pretext or on the need that more people's, more accounts should be opened for the poor rural people, and crony capitalism needed to be taken care of. But while there was an increase in savings and the opening of bank accounts back in the late 1960s, the kind of change that we saw between 2014 and 2019 is not something which we had ever experienced earlier on. And the benefit of that, you can see during the pandemic period, when the country was experiencing lockdowns. Many people were able to be taken care of by the government because of these schemes. The money could directly go into their accounts. There was no middleman. That was eliminated. And when it came to not just money, but also food and other help, that was being taken care of. So all these things were done in the first term. And I think somewhere, if you look at the number of beneficiaries of most of these schemes, was around 22 crores or 23 crores. And the number of votes by which were cast for the BJP in 2019 elections was somewhere in the same vicinity. So you can see that anybody who benefited kind of gave an affirmation and, you know, an okay to the government's report card. And that is how the government, the BJP managed to win more seats and come back with a bigger majority. So I think that work, the laying of internet connectivity, especially when it came to villages and Gram Panchayat, you can see that impact in the post-coronavirus world, where a lot of people, because of lockdowns, could work from home, could study from home. So all these things might not be visible right at the word get-go, but the impact can be felt. And I think that is a bigger indicator of a change or the work that the government did than anything else, because a government being voted back into power and with an overwhelming majority somewhere suggests that the people have given their approval for this.
Right. Yeah, it's very interesting that you bring up, right? And, you know, we've always been famously short of state capacity, and we've somehow transformed in the most trying circumstances possible. You know, let me just push back on that a little bit, right? I mean, some would argue that, you know, hey, this is a confluence of, you know, technological factors, perhaps some talent, bodies such as, you know, NCBI, for example, with UPI, Aadhaar, which was started, you know, way back when with Mr. Nandan Nilekani and so on, right? A bunch of these things are coming to bear at this point of time, very fortuitously for the government, right? But how much of this do you attribute to political intent and will and execution, actually?
Yeah, I think you have a fair point. And Mr. Modi also, on many occasions in the parliament and other platforms, has mentioned that government's work isn't continued. So you may upgrade something, you may change something, you may course correct, but it's a work in progress. And I think one big testimony to the Modi government's intent of getting things done or doing things, and for the want of a better term, doing things the right way, because you can see the results, is that you ultimately got it done. See, I live in Gurgaon, so I can give you an example that for a very long time, a lot of infrastructure work was not taking place in Gurgaon. It was not happening. And I've been here since the early 2000s. When I say that once the Khattar government came in 2014, the work, the speed of the work increased. So at that time also, when the rapid metro came in Gurgaon, a lot of people said that, you know, this is something which was taking place for a very long time. So you cannot give credit to the government or solely credit the government. But I don't think that political commentators have been looking at it in a slightly different light, because the potential was always there. The technology was always there. It's a work in progress. Also, that how do you bridge the final mile? I think all those things, political intent makes a very big difference in all these things. And see, for example, if you look at the Manmohan Singh government, a few key decisions that Prime Minister Dr. Singh wanted to take, he couldn't because of coalition compulsions. And he has been very vocal about these things, and he has been on record. A lot of previous prime ministers and governments have attributed some kind of a coalition compulsion for doing something or not being able to do something. I think in that aspect, the credit is definitely due to the Modi government, both in the first term and the second term, for the ground that they have covered, with the speed with which they have covered that ground. So yes, political opposition can say that some schemes were already in place and the government cannot take complete credit for that. But I think the numbers also speak for themselves. So if you're looking at the village electrification, or if you're looking at, you know, the kind of the bank accounts being opened, or any scheme where you can see the difference, the numbers speak the entire story. So I think in that aspect, a lot of things were possible because of the political intent and the political will of the Modi government in getting things done. And especially when it comes to defense and foreign policy, you see this at a bigger play.
Right. No, you're absolutely right. I think, you know, ideas are dime a dozen, right? But when we look at some of these, you know, schemes and stuff, whether it is the water scheme, Nalka Jal, I think it's called, Ujwala scheme, and so on and so forth, you wonder why we couldn't do this over the last 60 years before that, right? I mean, these are such obvious things, whether it's building roads or water supply or electricity and so on, right? You know, I want to go back to the question I asked you, which is, you know, Modi 1.0 set us up for Modi 2.0. What is the government doing right now in the Modi 2.0 regime that could potentially set us up for Modi 3.0? You know, I mean, is there such a thinking, is there such a vision? Something that you noticed?
Yes, I have. I don't look at it in terms of winning elections. That's a political reality. I mean, if you're a political party, the idea is to win elections. And a lot of people will say that, you know, there is no other choice, or Mr. Modi manages to win every time. But the question that I ask people is that, why do you win elections, or why do you fight elections? I think you're fighting and winning elections for the legislation aspect of it. So winning an election is one thing. But what do you do with that kind of mandate is a completely different ballgame. So in that aspect, if you see that a lot of long pending issues have been resolved in both terms of the Modi government. Take, for instance, the Jammu and Kashmir Reorganization Act. It is something which had been staring at us for a very long time in the face. And it was put to the floor of the House, and it was cleared by both houses. If you look at the Citizenship Amendment Bill, or even if you look at the farm laws. Now, the farm laws are something that every government has been talking for a very long time. And in fact, it was Atal Bihari Vajpayee's government which had set up the first National Commission for Farmers when Rajnath Singh was the agriculture minister back then. And that is the that commission M.S. Swaminathan's commission had also recommended a lot of changes which were never really implemented in, from the time the report was submitted up until now. So these are course corrections, actions, of course. These are also something which are trying to tell the people, see, 65% of this country is under the age of 25. And for that huge chunk of electorate, something which happened in 1999 is history. For people like me or my generation or perhaps your generation, even if you're irrespective of what generation you're at, that's something that you witnessed. So when you have this kind of an electorate, when you have this kind of a young population which is not interested in fighting elections for the sake of elections but doing something, then your actions end up setting up the foundation for a long haul. So in that aspect, if you look at the indications that Modi government was giving across the spectrum, was very clearly that, to quote a Hindi film song, you know, chodo kal ki baatein, kal ki baat purani. So you really had to move with the times. And I think these few landmark decisions and the shift in foreign policy, where India is no longer an afterthought when it comes to deciding the course of the world's future. We can look at the post-corona world, we can look at India's standoff with China, be it Doklam or be it Galwan. It is emerging as a very, very significant player. And that is something which the younger population identifies with. Younger population is not burdened with the legacy of past. It is not interested in how things used to be. This is a generation that will ask questions. This is a generation that fixes accountability. And if you look at Mr. Modi's style of working, there is a lot of this in his style of execution. He fixes accountability. There are targets which are measurable, which are measured. Like, I can give you an instance, which I also mentioned in my book. When it came to the electrification drive, I think it was a small little conversation between Mr. Piyush Goyal, who was the minister at that time, and Prime Minister in the parliament, where the Prime Minister just asked that, what are the numbers of villages where you have put LED bulbs instead of, and something like that. So Mr. Goyal said that I have to get back to you and I'll do that immediately. And in that conversation, I think the Prime Minister said that, why don't you have something which will show you a real-time, you know, progress. And Mr. Goyal's ministry came up with an app and you could see the change. So if you look at all these things, somewhere you are fixing accountability, because you're giving very clear-cut targets. Now, if you look at the Jal Se Nal, and if you look at the ground that it has covered right between, say, June, July 2019, where the elections were declared and this was set up, right now, the kind of ground that it has covered, it's phenomenal. And it is something which is available on ground, and there are numbers to support that, and also there are real-life testimonies. So in that aspect, if you see, yes, India's plan now is long-term thinking, and I don't think it is dependent on Modi 3.0 or Modi 4.0 or terms like that. These are technicalities. But you are looking at India emerging as a big player in the world, and especially if you look at how things have shaped up in the recent past. If you look at India becoming an alternative to China in terms of companies which are shifting out of China when it comes to manufacturing, or if you look at the development of geostrategic the new geo partnerships that India has become a part of, the revival of Quad, or if you're looking at how the Look East policy has completely now changed how India stands in this region, our interests in Africa, our tie-ups with countries all over the world, it's completely a different ballgame now from what it was in 2014, I remember that a lot of political commentators and pundits were of the opinion that sure, the Gujarat model or the promise of delivering what candidate Modi promised might not be completely true as Prime Minister Modi, because, you know, they were like, hey, Gujarat model is not going to work at a pan-India level, especially in foreign policy. But the first thing that the Prime Minister did was to invite the head of states of the SAARC nation, which is something that no think tank, no political commentator or pundit had, predicted. So that gave you an indication that this is a government which is going to do things unlike how it was done, because it places a different value to India. And that is something which you can see being played out now. And small example of this is that how the OPEC countries, when President Trump had approached them vis-a-vis the price, the crude oil price, the OPEC very openly said that we have to take into consideration what Prime Minister Modi of India says before we decide anything else. So these kind of things, look at the relationship that India has with the Arab nations today. India-Saudi relations are at, perhaps at its best. India-UAE relations are perhaps at its best. So these things are indication of a very long-term change when it comes to India. And right now, where we are at, the internal security of India and the external security of India are almost, they are interdependent. So anything which is going to impact India's geopolitics or India's global presence as a political entity is going to have an impact on the internal security as well, because we have Pakistan-based ISI on one end, which in 2015, the Pakistan Senate had very clearly recommended to then Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif that we have to exploit the fault lines in India and we have to promote an anti-Modi sentiment in India in order for Pakistan to stand, you know, neck to neck with India at a global stage. And you can see that between then and now, the dehyphenation between India and Pakistan is complete. Yeah. Anybody who thinks of India and Pakistan at the same level, I don't think either they are naive, but their people are not naive to that extent. So there is an agenda behind that.
Right. Yeah, I think you've wonderfully captured, you know, the essence of this, right? So I think Prime Minister Modi has sort of been able to capture the zeitgeist of the times. Rightly mentioned, the youth are not burdened by the legacy of being a third world country, right? I mean, and in fact, I think mine was perhaps the last generation that, you know, even heard the term being used. Today, I mean, we look at ourselves as an ascending power. A bunch of things have happened that reinforce that, right? I want to pick up on something which you mentioned, which is the fantastic election machinery that, you know, Prime Minister Modi and the BJP have managed to build, right? Even opponents of Prime Minister Modi tend to marvel at that, right? I mean, the way they're able to, like, you know, move all these various disparate parts together to really galvanize, you know, elections. What do you think the opposition is missing? What do you think they are not able to, you know, counter this and even copy this to a certain extent?
You know, I think somewhere sophologists believe that the electorate functions in a particular way. And I quote this, I give an example of this in my book, that in the run-up to the 2019 elections, a lot of people who were commenting on the political situation of India at that time, media, television, news debates, they were all convinced that the response to Pulwama is what sealed the election for Mr. Modi. I don't think so. I think it played a very important role because it once again displayed a political will and intent. And I think therein lies the answer, because that is what the opposition is not offering. When you look at politics or when you look at a democratic process, you can't carry on complaining about the incumbent or complaining about the other party. At some point, you have to give an alternative. You have to suggest that this is what is happening. This is what we will do, which is what the 2014 elections were, where the BJP and with the party president Rajnath Singh, the manifesto and the prime ministerial candidate Narendra Modi made it very clear that this is what we promised to do. So in that aspect, when sophologists or political commentators traveled to back up beyond and to interior India, they asked people that who would you vote for? And when they heard we will vote for Modi, then they asked that why would you vote for Modi? And somebody, and I mentioned this incident in my book, though I don't name the journalist, the person responded that the way Narendra Modi has created India's image, pure vishwa mein Narendra Modi ne Bharat ki jo ek chhabi banayi hai, usse hum bahut khush hai, we feel very proud, and that is why we vote for him. Now this guy asked that voter, how does it make a difference to you what the world thinks of India? Now I asked this person that why would you think that an average Indian would not be interested in how he, she, or their country is perceived globally. Because at the end of the day, it is your country. You are your country's ambassador when you go out. You are told to behave in a certain way because you are projecting your country. And if the prime minister is doing the same thing, why would it not play a factor in your deciding whom to vote for? So a lot of people miss the whole picture, because they think that the electorate behaves in a certain way. So for a cadre-based party like BJP, which is a very well-oiled machinery, it's not surprising that they come into their own when it comes to elections, because they have a mechanism in place where you know how the electorate is thinking, what the electorate is thinking. In fact, two incidents. One is Piyush Goyal before the 2019 elections mentioned in one of these conclaves or lit fests or what have you, I forget that. But he mentioned that we have done a survey and we are going to get between 298 seats to 303 seats. This is exactly what he said. And that is what the BJP got. And the other is that in an op-ed piece, Mr. Hardeep Singh Puri had mentioned that these were the number of beneficiaries of our programs and these were the number of votes that we got. So not that every single person voted for us, but you get the picture. So I think somewhere the opposition is still believing that a certain kind of Indian electorate still exists, and that is how they're working on. That is why their election campaigns are designed like that. That is how they approach their electorate. Now, if you look at the Congress manifesto, it did for the 2019 elections, it did offer something which was not on the cards. The public didn't accept it, didn't respond to it. That's a completely different story. But unless you offer your plan, your program, your alternative, the youth is not interested. See, today, I can give you an example which is not directly related, but it gives an insight. Look at cinema in India today. It's completely going bamboozled by the whole OTT phenomenon. But what big Bombay producers are not understanding is that people today are willing to pay money, not for content, but for their time. So if I'm willing to pay 10 rupees for an OTT program, I'm not paying 10 rupees because it's just 10 rupees. I'm paying because I think that what I'm going to see is going to be worthy of my time. Now, they are not going to pay that kind of money when it comes to cinema halls because of the choice that they have today. So unless you give them something, unless you very clearly offer them something, they're not going to come back to you with the same fervor. And I think that is what the opposition is missing, that they are more interested in targeting this image of Narendra Modi. And I think in the run-up to the 2019 elections, for a newspaper, for a magazine interview, Rahul Gandhi very clearly said that I am going to target Modi's image, because that is what I want to target. That's not going to work because 2019 elections gave you an indication of that. So I think somewhere the opposition needs to present its program, connect with the electorate that this is what we offer you and why this is a better option. You can't say that what they are doing will do the opposite of that. See, you can't take wrong argument just to be contrarian because the right argument has already been taken by somebody.
No, I think there's also an element of condescension, right? When we look at the masses of the country, I mean, and we say that, hey, I mean, you don't have that Bijli Sadak Pani, why should you care about, you know, India's image or something of that sort? It also betrays a certain thinking that in your head, you think that these people should not have to do anything, should not have anything to do with all these other elements, right? Which is not true, I think. Yeah. So let's talk about some of the key events that have happened in the second term, right? It could be the Doklam standoff that happened, right? And then obviously the coronavirus is a big deal. These are very interesting times, as I mentioned earlier. I mean, we're seeing potentially the prospect of a two-front war on the cards, right? In all of this, I mean, how do you think Prime Minister Modi has managed?
I think the government has done a fantastic job. It's still a work in progress. I think in this term, a few key things like the whole defense and the foreign policy that India has now adopted, and especially the changes in the defense setup, like the finally with this term when Rajnath Singh became the defense minister, Modi government finally fulfilled the post of the CDS. And that has really changed the way things function when it comes to manufacturing in India, especially Atmanirbhar Bharat psyche when it comes to defense equipment. That has also played a very big role. See, also the two-pronged war, the threat of that is always there because it's not hidden anymore. This is a very clear-cut indication that India is a very big threat to China. India is a very big threat to Pakistan. And also a lot of systems which are in place that are continuously propagating events surrounding these two fronts. So there is no change in the ISI-backed outfits, in the ISI-backed mentality, in the ISI-backed program. There has been no change in the CCP-backed programs. And especially if you see in the cyber space, it has completely changed. The war is not going to be a conventional war anymore. And I think in that aspect, the government has not only taken note of it, but also made a few changes which have set up a new system in place where India is not going to look at these problems from the same old perspective that it was looking. It has made a great inroads into the relations with the Arab world. Today, Saudi Arabia, the Emirates, India is on a fantastic wicket with these two countries. And the fact that something like the JNK Reorganization Act, where the Article 370 was done away with, did not see the world respond the way a lot of pundits would have you, would make you believe that you can't do this because that is what is going to happen. There is going to be this kind of a response or that kind of a response. So all these things are indications that it is not the same old story anymore. So I think the defense overall, like foreign policy, the revival of Quad, now that becomes a very, very big and important thing because the Quad came into being in the late 2000s. So 2008, 9, 10 comes into play, but it completely gets sidetracked. It changes because of lack of political intent or will at that time. It's only post 2014-15 when it starts reviving, and the relationship between India and Australia has completely changed from that point onwards to now. So I think India's presence, India's geographical presence, India's change of its attitude, especially in the Indian Ocean region, the fact that India came face to face with China and did not buckle under pressure has also sent a big message to not just countries around this area, especially, China's misadventures in South China Sea. Countries like Taiwan, countries like Australia are now standing up to China. And I think that somewhere started with India. And it's not just this aspect, the defense aspect, but also trade, where India is now, India has completely become like an alternative to China. So I think these few things, the government is observing them very closely. And I think the next few years are going to be a huge battleground, especially when it comes to India stamping its authority and ensuring that we don't go back to the point where 1/7 of humanity did not matter when it came to making global decisions.
So, we've had a difficult 18 months, right, under the grip of the pandemic, and we had seen that the economy kind of bottomed out, but we're seeing a revival, right? The GST collections have picked up, export numbers are, trending positively month on month. And, we might have potentially 1 or 2 years of good economic growth for the country, right, ahead of the 2024 elections. But what do you think are the risks from here on, for the Prime Minister and the government at the center?
I think post-coronavirus world is a completely different ballgame. And right now, there's been a lot of talk about the whole probability of coronavirus being a bioweapon. America has made this, accused China of not dealing the right way. So what I'm essentially trying to say is that the possibility of a new kind of threat always exists. And right now, we are seeing that the world is at a very... There is a lot of transformation taking place across the world. A lot of things, how they used to be, are no longer going to function like that. A large part of this is because of the coronavirus pandemic. But I think one of the big challenges would be that what we saw between the first wave and the second wave, where there was, the economy was reviving, it was opening. And this has happened to many countries across the world. So I think that that safety needs to be looked at, that there is no threat which will apply the brakes all over again. And I think in that aspect, there is a constant threat from the Chinese Communist Party out there, which is trying to stamp its own authority onto the world. And the more things become normal, there is a possibility that how things were going, were taking place before the pandemic, the world might go back to that in terms of how countries were dealing with each other. So in that aspect, yes, there will be a period. The next 2-3 years are going to be very important because you have to maintain the fine balance between lives and livelihood, because the pandemic is still, it's not been called off, it's not been eradicated. Our vaccination drive is very well placed right now. 100 crore people have been vaccinated, at least one jab. So things are improving across the board. But this threat from China and ISI and the way India's change in fortunes have taken place, especially as a huge geostrategic and a global player, that will always be targeted. So to believe that this is going to change would be wrong. And I think that you can only hurt a country by killing its people and killing its economy. which has been attempted vis-a-vis India for a very long time. And I think the government is in a very good state right now when it comes to addressing these issues. So right now, be it the COVID-19 vaccines, be it the economy getting revived, like the numbers that you mentioned, it is a very good indication. It also reaffirms the faith in the present dispensation and the way it's handling the situation. But I think next 2-3 years are going to be very important, very key, because a lot of things are changing in the world, especially if you look at the way the focus is going to shift from China to, say, India, or, you know, you're going to question China on multiple fronts. So I think in that aspect, there will be a lot of attention on India, and enemies of India would not like India's talk to change. So nothing is off the table. And especially in today's world where conventional wars might not take place, you really don't know from which aspect the enemy is going to attack you. And, you know, this is very evident in a lot of things. Like, for example, there's nothing wrong in people protesting. People have a right to protest. In a democracy, you have a right to express yourself. There have been instances in the past, which is very well documented, that enemies of this country can take advantage of that situation and shift. Like, for example, if you look at certain reports which are coming out, that anti-national elements have infiltrated certain protests. Like, for example, in my book also, I mentioned that the CAA protest became like a recruiting ground, a testing area for ISI and IS-backed operatives to pick up people who could attack India. Any anti-India sentiment would be encouraged and promoted. And most of this was taking place through the internet, through cyberspace. And even the protests all over the country, the farmer protests, there have been instances where people have infiltrated. So there is a strong possibility that, and like I mentioned earlier also, that the 2015 document of Pakistan Senate, which clearly mentions that you have to exploit Hindu-Muslim fault lines, Hindu-Sikh fault lines, the caste fault lines. So these need to be addressed by us as a country, that at the end of the day, it is the Constitution of India which, you know, binds us. And that is the final word. But in the interim, when you are expressing your protest or expressing your displeasure about something, you have the right to do so. But be aware that there may be elements which can infiltrate and take over this and change the aspect. And that is one of the biggest threats to India, especially from ISI and CCP-backed operatives. That has been very well documented also.
Right. Yeah. What you're essentially saying is the threats are more external than internal, right? Because just given the amount of, given whatever is at stake, I mean, economically, politically, geopolitically, basically, right, that you cannot rule out external entities, you know, meddling in our internal affairs, right? You know, we've spoken a fair bit about the government's achievements, and a lot of those are objectively good, right? I mean, if you look at some of those schemes that we mentioned and so on, but the mainstream portrayal of Prime Minister Modi, the mainstream media portrayal seems to be less than flattering, right? And it's also because I think there is a certain aesthetic that, you know, it doesn't augur well with the media, I suppose, right? I mean, the Prime Minister goes direct to the masses, right, through the Mann Ki Baat or through social media, right? And doesn't practice the formally, you know, former convention of access journalism, where, you know, certain people would, you know, be privy to ministerial berths and that kind of information. But do you see this mainstream media narrative change?
See, at the end of the day, media is a business. And a business needs to, you know, make money. So if that kind of access journalism, which used to exist once upon a time, does not find any space in Narendra Modi's regime, then the media needs to understand that they have been made irrelevant to some extent, especially when it comes to connecting. So through Mann Ki Baat or Twitter, most of the ministers in this government, and not just ministers in this government, but any public office, anybody in public life today, be it the opposition also, all netas and ministers have a very vibrant social media presence. They are very accessible. There is 1 degree of separation between me and the Prime Minister of India today, or anybody and the Prime Minister of India. There is a lot of interest in these platforms when it comes to feedback. Especially when it comes to Prime Minister Modi, looking at how people get in touch with him, and there is a kind of addressal. Like, I can give you instances and examples which from my own life, or which I quote in the book also, that anybody who gets in touch with the government ministry today gets a reward. So that just shows you that the job profile of media has changed. Media, which once upon a time prided itself in saying that, you know, they were the bridge between the electorate and the office, is no longer there. So the media needs to understand that the world is existing without them, because alternative media has also come up in a very big way. There is information, there is misinformation also. I'm not denying that. Traditional media is not just the only source left for people to know what is happening in the world. And in that aspect, if a prime minister's connect, or say President Trump, now take the example of Donald Trump. The fact that a sitting US president could be deplatformed from the social media environment tells you A, what kind of connect he had, and B, why social media is important, or why this is a very important platform. A lot of traditional media or old school media, I don't think takes social media seriously even today. Initially, in the early days of social media, for traditional media houses, it was like, yeah, jo newspaper mein aaj subah ja raha hai, usi ki story bana ke update kar do, website pe dal do. That doesn't exist anymore. So I think somewhere access journalism has completely been thrown out of the window. So the media needs to understand that they cannot be airing their frustration to some extent, because a lot of reportage seems to be driven by some other agenda than the agenda of, you know, reporting. So that needs to be understood by the media. And I think that, I don't know whether that will change or that may not change, but the fact that post Donald Trump, if you look at some ratings in the US, media ratings, they have completely tanked. So the fact remains that if you do not report things the way they are, and people get to see the things the way they are by some other means, then they will not come back to you, or they are not going to continue their patronage the way. Especially also, if you see post-coronavirus, the markets have completely changed. A lot of media outlets had to bite the bullet when it came to downsizing or reorganize themselves. That had been in the making for a very long time. And I think the economic blow, which was, you know, dealt by pandemic, kind of changed a lot of things. But yeah, I mean, media has every right to question. But if you still ask that, why is the Prime Minister not holding press conferences, or, you know, that's a completely different ballgame. You can question. This book also speaks about the shortcomings of the government. It also speaks about the challenges that lay in front of the government. So it's not like that the criticism is not there or the questioning is not there. But it has to be relevant. It can't be the same way like, bhai, अगर इंडिया की इमेज ग्लोबली अच्छी होगी तो उससे तुम्हें क्या फर्क पड़ता, तुम अपनी बिजली पानी सड़क की फिक्र करो, बट इफ यू हैड टू वरी अबाउट द बिजली पानी सड़क फॉर 75 इयर्स, देन देयर इज समथिंग लैकिंग ऑन योर फ्रंट दैट यू आर नॉट बीइंग एबल टू फुलफिल दीस प्रॉमिसेस,
राइट? Yeah, I think, you know, they have to fight harder for their influence, right? I think the earlier times where it was fairly easy to kind of control that narrative is no longer relevant today in the era of social media and decentralization. One of the common tropes that we see is that any critic of the government is deemed anti-national, right? Anti-government is deemed anti-national. Is there some truth to that entire, you know, proposition that, you know, everything is somehow deemed as a subversion, or that, you know, as we spoke about earlier.
I see, but I understand what you mean. I don't think that, at least for the people, it's that simplistic and that clear cut. The fact that a lot of people are saying that the opposition to government is opposition to the country is also a narrative, if I can use that term here, and I'm using it very, very carefully, which is presented to you. Yes, on certain aspects, when you're questioning certain actions of the government, which were taken in national interest, and you question that, yeah, from a point of view of a debate, it can be asked whether it is anti-national or not. But I don't think it is that simplistic for people. There have been a lot of, like take the instance that I feel that the farm laws are a very important milestone. I think that they are actually empowering the farmer for the first time. I don't know why there is this kind of an opposition to it, because you haven't done away with the system, with the previous system. The mandis are still there. You can still access them. It is giving farmers a little more freedom. I mean, it's preposterous to think that before these laws, a farmer from a particular state could not sell his or her produce in some other state, and they would have gotten arrested for that. They would be breaking the law. If I were to say this to a filmmaker, that you make a film, you can release it in Mumbai, but you can't release it in Chennai. And if you release your film in Chennai, you'll be arrested. They'll cry blue murder, and then they'll cry all sorts of things. And, you know, they'll think that I'm an idiot or I'm a fool. But the same logic cannot be applied by them or people, you know, from that fraternity when it comes to the farm laws. So the narrative is being built in a particular way. There is a huge influx of Chinese money and Chinese Communist Party backed organization in media. It's been very well documented. In fact, Australia suffered so much that one of the books that I quote, that I refer to in my book, there's a book which came out and it named a whole plethora of people, right from politicians to media houses, about the Chinese money. And it was very well documented there. And people had to resign from public office because they had taken kickbacks from the CCP. So that is a reality which cannot be denied. And I think that China was such a big player that the money is there in all these places. So a lot of this narrative that criticizing the government is also criticizing the country is created and pushed. You like, for instance, take the whole, I haven't followed the issue so closely, but from what I gathered, the trolling of Mohammad Shami after one of these cricket matches, a lot of it originated from Pakistan. There were reports which came that a lot of these handles were Pakistan-based handles. And when you say anything which is Pakistan-based, China-based, you wouldn't be wrong in thinking that that is ISI-backed or CCP-backed. Because there is a machinery which is in place. And it is, again, like I keep saying, there is documented proof of this. So to say that criticizing the government is criticizing the country, that's not entirely true. But yeah, on some issues which the government has taken a call, which is in the benefit of the country, and then you're questioning that. Of course, from a point of view, I mean, if you are free to say that, I can criticize this government even if it is at the cost of this country because I live in India and that is what democracy offers me, then somebody questioning your stance can also be allowed or should also be allowed, but because that's also freedom of expression. Exactly. Now, as long as it is in the purview of the law, as long as it is not hurting somebody, it's not breaking any law, I mean, it's absolutely valid in this country. But I don't think people are so simplistic and so naive.
Yeah, absolutely. What do you make of the critique that the government communication has been lacking or faulty on multiple fronts, let's say the farm laws and so on? Because I feel that even in the case of the farm laws, right, I think they had like 14 or 15 conventions with the farmers associations and so on and so forth. We see that, you know, the various departments of the government are fairly active on social media. They respond to queries, etc. Mann Ki Baat is almost happening on a weekly basis for many, many, you know, months and years now, right? Even despite all of this, people do bring up this critique that, you know, somehow the government's positioning on some of these things or the branding or the communication is lacking. What is your opinion on that?
So I don't think that there is anything that lacks when it comes to communication. Like, for example, there was a thought which was propagated that CAA ke saath NRC bhi aa jayega. A lot of fairly popular young people who have great following and whatever they say is heard with great intent. They were completely unaware on certain aspects of these laws. Where was the NRC? Of course, there were some statements that yes, there should be an NRC. Yes, an NRC should come. The time is ripe for an NRC. But there was never anything which was official about the NRC. But if you look at the whole CA protest, a lot of narrative was built around the fact that CA aage, NRC aajayegi and Muslims will lose their citizenship. It was nothing to do with that. It was about providing citizenship on a fast-track basis to people who were religiously persecuted in the neighboring theocratic states of India. Now, this was debated in the parliament. And this is not something which just happened in 2019. I mean, this was a part of the Constituent Assembly's debates, which I also cover extensively in my book, because my focus is also to juxtapose a historical context with what is happening in contemporary India. For the younger reader, because I feel that a lot of them don't have ready access and access which is helpful in providing a perspective which can at least make the young mind think. Of course, people can say that you can go to the Government of India's website, you can go to the Lok Sabha website, you can access the old PDF documents which are there, and you can look at the whole Constituent Assembly debates between what Sardar Bhupinder Singh said or what Shri Punjab Rao Deshmukh said or what Pandit Nehru responded by or what was Dr. Ambedkar's stance on citizenship. These are all there in public domain. But there also has to be something which is readily accessible, which the young can, you know, directly look into. And I think that is what I was intending with this book. So in that aspect, I feel that something which has been debated in the parliament, something which has gone through the due process of the democratic setup that, you know, India prides itself in. Even media houses were reporting that this was bulldozed through the parliament. It's very naive and stupid to say. And a lot of people were endorsing this thought. So if you look at the farm laws also, a lot of people, I'm sorry to say, but have not read the laws. They don't know what the farmer is benefiting. They don't know that nothing is being taken away from the farmer. And the government has had extensive talks with the farmers who were agitating. All ministers regularly hold press conferences, take the whole Central Vista project, which was linked with a great house being made for the Prime Minister, which also, look at the new parliament which is being made. I mean, that is something which has been in the making for a very long time, because next year after the deletion of the Lok Sabha, seats will change. Right now, there is no space in the Lok Sabha. And this is something which the previous governments have also been considering. So now, for media houses to give that thrust, that is something which, and then blame the government that your communication is not good enough. Sure, I mean, you can say that, because at the end of the day, you have a market and you're adhering to that. But just take into consideration that when public figures who are approached by the media for a soundbite, and some of them say that so many people present here cannot be wrong, and that is why I'm supporting what I'm supporting, or I'm not supporting what I'm not supporting. Basing your argument on that is really stupid. I mean, for Imran Khan to say that government of India ne ye tanashaha hukum pass kar diya, ek farman pass kar diya. I mean, Pakistan mein aisa hota hoga. I mean, that's a country which has had military dictators ruling for more years than the democratic setup there. Or China, where the communists can pulverize anything. This might happen in those countries. But there is a parliament here, and there is a due process which is followed here. There's a Supreme Court which takes cognizance of things. And for media to say that irrespective of all these things, the government's communication is wrong, is a little rich. I think that people also read between the lines. I think that internet connectivity in this country is fantastic. People have access to just about anything at the fingertips. And a lot of English media or media based out of metros in India, Mumbai or Delhi se bahar agar aap nikalenge, Chennai se bahar agar aap nikalenge, bahut badi duniya hai. And that world is very well aware of what is happening around them. That is the reason that when it comes to elections, results go a certain way and don't go a certain way, because this just tells you that people are a little more aware of what is happening than what you would say. I think that I go back to the point that union ministers are holding press conferences, they are tweeting, they are writing op-ed pieces which are very widely circulated, and there are reactions to those op-ed pieces. So I don't think the government can do anything more when it comes to effective communication. But if that communication is painted in a certain light, then, I mean, it's like they say, it's open season.
Right. Final couple of questions before we let you go. You know, we're living in a very polarized world, right? Anything that you say or do can be misconstrued to mean one thing or the other. And there is a real risk to holding some of these views, right? Even if it is, let's say, something objective, as much of what we have spoken about is. What has been your experience? I ask this because, you know, you come from the film world, and, you know, the film world is not entirely, some would say it's also slightly, you know, antithetical to the Prime Minister's or the current dispensation, right? So what has been your experience like?
So yes, it is a world where extreme thoughts are given more importance, bigger platforms. But then again, that is done by platforms or outlets which appear to have a vested interest. You can express yourself freely in this country. I don't think that there is a problem on that front. There is a reaction, there is a backlash, but some of it is also manufactured. So, like, if people can express themselves, and let's take any instance where businesses change their stance based on the feedback of people, be it an ad which people don't like or a comment which invites backlash. A lot of it is also propagated and mass generated by people, by platforms again, I go back to the whole thing. I mean, to some, I may sound like a stuck record that I keep going back to ISI-backed way of functioning, but it is a reality. It is a fact that a lot of cyber activity originates from across the border. But having said that, if a person expresses his or her view and there is a reaction to that and a business house decides to change, then I don't think it is right to blame the reaction or the force with which the reaction comes, because it is a business decision. When you decided to do something, there was a reason for you to do that. When you decide to do something after that, there is another reason for that. Maybe you don't realize that the ticket paying audience or the ticket paying member of the public may not give you that money anymore. And you take a call, you do a cost benefit analysis, and you take a certain call. Yes, people are more expressive. Yes, the outlets today allow people to express themselves more freely. Yes, they can be misused. But also, as long as it is not breaking any law, I think people are free to express themselves. And yes, you have to stand by what you say. I mean, it is a view coming out of you. I would say that it is not that kind of a world where you could say anything randomly, you know, and you could just get on with life. You have to be a responsible person, or you can have a devil may care attitude. It's totally up to you. You decide how you want to be. You decide what you want. And you have to take a call at your own level that, do you want to support somebody who's propagating violence, or do you want to support somebody who's propagating peace and who's saying that take a moment to think before you do something. You are free to express yourself. Any view that you have may be taken by an extreme view by the other person. How do you react? What is it that you want to do? I mean, there are certain things that I may not like about governments, or I may not like about political people, but as long as it is not breaking any law, as long as it is not threatening somebody, they have a right to express themselves. So yes, the world is a little polarized. There are clear-cut demarcations when it comes to writing, when it comes to political thought, or when it comes to your views. People don't, or at least platforms would make you believe that you have to choose a side. I don't think that's completely true. I think that you can have a fairly balanced approach. Yes, you may find it difficult for, you know, people to, as an author, I can say this, that there is a very polarizing effect. If you write a certain kind of thing, there's a bigger market for it. If you write a certain kind of thing, there might not be a big market for that. But that is also your decision, what you are expressing. And I think that people are also being forced by this whole environment, this media frenzy, the social media frenzy, also the fact that today everything happens so instantly that we are also somewhere interested in that. I need to get a feedback now. I need an answer right away. I mean, I now think that, you know, sometimes it has become so bad that I get an email, I want to instantly respond to it, because, and when I do that and I don't get a response, somewhere I start thinking that, why am I not getting a response? So yes, I think the pace with which the life is playing and life is passing us by, or things are happening, has also made us run after some kind of a answer. I think that we need to let people express themselves. Once again, I go back to the same thing, that as long as it is not illegal, as long as it is not threatening somebody, people have a right to express themselves. And I think you need to take a call of where you want to stand when it comes to reacting to something, when it comes to putting out a thought. It's completely your choice. You need to make this choice. There is a machinery in place. There's a government in place. There's a system in place. There's a whole law and order apparatus in place. But that is for you, and that is also by you. So I think as individuals, we need to decide. And like I keep going back and saying that, I mean, you don't need like that Bob Dylan song, you don't need a weatherman to tell you which way the wind is blowing. So you can take your own call.
Right. I think all of us are still trying to adapt to that 15-year-old or 20-year-old phenomenon of social media, right? When viewed in perspective of hundreds of years, if not thousands of years, of how humans normally functioned, I think it's still a relatively new phenomenon that you have all of the world's knowledge at your fingertips and everything is bombarding you minute to minute, right? The way human psyche responds to that, and this form of a heightened tribalism, the ease with which you can form these cohorts, right, of different people and, you know, go against something or for something is still something that's developing. And I'm not sure if we know everything there is to know about this, right? So, you know, finally, you have an upcoming book on Vinod Khanna, if I'm not mistaken, right? What should the audience expect? And why was he such a fascinating character? Why did you choose this?
For me, it's very interesting to look at people who both capture the environment that they operate in, capture the zeitgeist, and redefine it. I think there has been a lot of presentism when it comes to contemporary history and historians' fallacy, where we are trying to not see things the way they were. See, historians love the idea of time. They love to see the impact of something over a period of time. But I also think that contemporary history needs to be chronicled without the burden of presentism. And for me, I think the focus on when I choose my subjects or when I choose my books, sometimes they choose me also. Like for example, writing on Mr. Rajnath Singh was a fascinating experience because he has been someone who has been in every important office through the course of political journey in India. He starts off in student politics. He was a party cadre. He was with the Sangh. He becomes the youth leader of BJP. He becomes the president of BJYM Uttar Pradesh, then BJYM India, then becomes chief minister of India's biggest state. He's the last chief minister of undivided Uttar Pradesh also. So historically, he's at that point. He witnesses, he's incarcerated during the emergency. So, and also becomes the party president of BJP for two very, very significant elections, 2009 and 2014. One was a defeat which nobody expected. And the magnitude of the other victory was something that shocked people. So for a man who was leading the party in 2009, biggest electoral defeat of that era, to 2014, also then becoming the home minister. So for me, looking at his life also gave me a sense of looking at India. And what had happened was that a lot of political discourse in this country was not given the kind of focus that it deserved, largely because it was the opposition. So if you look at Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, if you look at Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay, then if you look at the entire emergency period where the opposition was in prison, you don't have as much literature on that for a younger generation as much as there should be. So for me, Vinod Khanna is a very interesting aspect of popular Hindi films, because he's something who goes from being a very popular villain. I mean, he was a villain who was much bigger than heroes of his era. He and somebody like Mr. Shatrughan Sinha, they used to say that unki entry pe zyada taliyan basti thi as opposed to the hero. Then he becomes somebody who's the only person who could have been a contender for the number one crown during Mr. Amitabh Bachchan's phenomenal rise. He gives it all up and makes a fantastic comeback. So for me, a huge segment of Hindi films where actors like Dharmendra, Rajendra Kumar, Manoj Kumar, Govinda, Vinod Khanna, they were undisputed box office kings, but they were never given that number one crown. And a lot of history is done away with. So for me, Vinod Khanna becomes a very interesting aspect that in a glamorous profession, he is somebody who's seeking something which is deep within him, and he embraces spirituality, leaves everything, and then comes back. The only reason Vinod Khanna came back was because there was some legal trouble with the Osho commune in the United States, and their life could not continue that way. So he was not interested in coming back because he was done with spirituality in that aspect. So for me, chronicling Vinod Khanna's life is also taking a look at a kind of leading man phenomenon, which was not given its due. And with that, I'm also looking at a lot of actors like Zeenat Aman, Parveen Babi, who were a part of this Vinod Khanna phenomenon. But again, you know, because of Hema Malini being the number one, or Rekha being looked at or spoken in that aspect, you don't focus on these people. So an entire industry's legacy or history is done away with. So for me, that is very important. Also, as luck would have it, you know, the actors whom I have written about, be it Rajesh Khanna or Vinod Khanna now, or a little bit of Hemaji while writing on Rajesh Khanna, a lot about Mr. Amitabh Bachchan. I wrote a book on Pink, the film, the making of it. And I got to speak a lot to Mr. Bachchan, who also wrote the foreword for the book. They were all involved in politics at that time, at some point in the career. And Vinod Khanna, in fact, was also the Minister of State for External Affairs. So that's a fairly important position for somebody like him. He won 5 elections from Gurdaspur. So that also gives me an idea that the connect that he had with people. And his films were not as big when he was a politician. So how could the younger electorate vote for somebody like him? So if they voted for him thinking of Vinod Khanna the actor, so they were a little more aware of his films. So all these things come into play. So that is something that I'm looking to explore with biography of Mr. Vinod Khanna.
Wow, sounds fascinating, and we will definitely have you back to discuss the new book when it's out. This was a superb conversation, Gautamji. I mean, I think we covered plenty of aspects, and I would encourage all readers to definitely check out The Midway Battle. It's available on Amazon, Flipkart, and everywhere else. Thank you again, Gautamji. Thank you so much for being on Bharat Varta, and I look forward to chatting with you very soon.
Thank you so much. It was entirely my pleasure and lovely to be here. Thanks.